let the mountains move. We come with expectation, waiting here for you.
Favor. God is good to his people. Can
yes,
I get an
amen.
Amen? Praise God. How many of you are excited to be in the house of the Lord?
Amen.
It feels good to be able to fellowship with our brothers and our sisters in the Lord. Amen. And in this beautiful day, we have a wonderful message. We are actually going to continue in the same subject matter as last week. Last week, we brought a message regarding mercy, the ministry of mercy that we are called to. How many of you acknowledge that God is calling us to a ministry of mercy? Amen. Do you acknowledge that? To start off the message, I'd like to reiterate just and define the word mercy and also the word compassion. Because these are two key words that are going to be found again in this next part of the series that we have been covering. Amen. I'd like for us to begin. The word mercy is defined as compassion or forgiveness shown towards someone whom it is within your power to punish or harm. Can I get an amen if you understand?
Amen.
And also the word compassion, which is very, very similar and very close to the word mercy. The word compassion is defined as sympathetic pity and concern for the sufferings or misfortunes of somebody else. Do we acknowledge? Amen. I'm wondering in this beautiful afternoon if you all had some coffee to drink. Everybody's like spaced out. Earth to you all, come back. Today we're going to be titling this message, Being an Agent of Mercy in the World. Amen?
Amen.
How many of you are going to be agents of mercy?
Yes.
Declare it. I am going to be an agent of mercy. I'm going to show mercy to those that are in need of mercy. And Jesus, he declared it very clearly. How many of you know, after Jesus died and resurrected, he spoke to his disciples and he basically told them, he said, and you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. How many of you heard that? Amen. You will receive power and authority when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And this power that you're going to receive is so that you can go out, Jesus said, and be my witnesses. Jesus gives us the power so that we can speak about him. Jesus gives us the power to show people mercy, those that are in need, those that lack mercy. Amen. There are principles of mercy. How many of you acknowledge that? There are certain principles for mercy. The question today is, how can I be more merciful? That is the question that we should ask ourselves today. I'd like for us to start off by going to the book of Philippians. We're going to go to the New Testament. Philippians chapter 2, verse 4. You can say amen once you get there with me. Praise God. Philippians chapter 2. I want you to have your Bibles ready because we're going to be doing some scripture searching today. We're going to allow God to speak to us directly through his word. Amen. Philippians chapter 2. We're going to be reading verse 4. There are principles of mercy. The question today is, how can I be more merciful? Philippians 2, 4 says, everyone should look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. Jesus is breaking it down through the apostle, and he shares with us this message today. The apostle Paul, he shares this message. And the message is, my brothers and my sisters, that we should not look out for ourselves, that we should not be selfish, that we should be selfless. Amen? There are people that have the mentality, they say, you do you, and I'll do me. How many of you know somebody like that? That's that worldly perspective. That's the worldly mentality. The mentality that we should have as disciples of Jesus Christ is the, I know you're going through something, and I'm interested in what you're going through. So, you know, if it helps you out, I want you to know that I am here for you. You see? So here the apostle says, and I must repeat, he says, everyone should look out not only for their own interests, not only for what is going to benefit me, but what is going to benefit everybody else around me. Amen? There are people that make decisions, and those decisions are very selfish. Those decisions, you know, many times people make choices that are not only, that at that moment they feel like it's benefiting them, but if you think about it, it's not benefiting everyone else that is around them. For example, as a father of three, husband to one, there are many choices that I can make that can temporarily benefit me, but affect my family. You see? And what the word is teaching us today is that we should be very careful about the interests of others. You see, the world teaches us a different state of mind, a different mentality. In the world, the mentality is, as I mentioned, you do you. There's people that actually go so far to say, you do you, boo-boo. How many of you have heard that? Or am I going crazy? Right? And I'll do me. You see? But in the ways of the Lord, things are different. The Lord doesn't want us to be the same way as the world is. The Lord wants us to actually be interested. Your brother, your sister is going through something. The least we can do is say, can I help you with anything? Would it help you if I were to do this? Or do you need anything? Amen? I believe that if we are to be agents of mercy here on earth, we must act on the mercy that God has shown us. How many of you acknowledge, you recognize that God has shown you mercy?
Yeah, that's right.
Amen? So since God has shown you mercy, now it's your turn to show mercy to others, to those that need it. Amen?
Amen.
So we must look out for one another's interests and not only for our own interests. We must think of others when we decide. We must think of others when we make those choices. Jesus, I'd like for us to go to Mark chapter 10. I told you we're going to do some scripture searching, and I hope that you're with me today. I want you to be alert. I know that some of you did not drink coffee today, but after we get out of here, you can go stop by Dunkin' Donuts and make them rich. Because I know I sure will. So Mark chapter 10, verse 21. Principles of mercy. That is what we're covering right now. Principles of mercy. The first principle of mercy is the one, the verse that we just read, which speaks about looking out. Looking out for everyone else's interest and not only yourself. Another principle of mercy is this right here. So we're reading Mark 10:21. Are we there?
Amen.
Then, looking at him, Jesus loved him and said to him, you lack one thing. Go, sell all you have, and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me. The first thing that the word teaches us right here in verse 21 is, then looking at him. Jesus stopped for a moment and he looked at him. Some of you are like, what did we just read? The Bible teaches us that there was this rich young ruler that came up to Jesus and he said, Master, what must I do to inherit the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus said, well, you must obey the commands. You must listen to the word of God. You must keep the word of God and continue walking in God's ways. And this young man says, but I've done this. I've honored my mother and my father. I've tried my best to keep the word. And he says, what else must I do? And Jesus, in that moment, Jesus stopped because he saw the hunger and the thirst that this man had for the kingdom of God. And Jesus looked at him. He stopped. He looked at him. And he said, but you must do one thing, one more thing. Grab everything that you have. Go and sell it. And whatever you make, give it to the poor. My brothers and sisters, right now some of you are like, I really don't want to sell my house and give the proceeds to the poor. This particular case was for this particular person because this particular person was too attached to material things. So Jesus said, listen, if you really want to follow me, you're going to have to let go of those things. Because right now, what I'm noticing is that those things that you have, those material possessions that you have, you really don't have them. They have you. And if you want to inherit the kingdom of God, then what I expect of you is for you to let go of those things. How many of you acknowledge that sometimes we need to let go of the material things?
Amen.
There are some of us that we're just stuck on the material things. And everything is, I want this, I want that, and my this and my that. In this case, Jesus had to speak to this man. He stopped. But I want you to notice how Jesus was merciful and how Jesus was compassionate. And it's 10:21 again. Then looking at him, Jesus loved him. Jesus stopped. He looked at him and he loved him. And he said, you want the kingdom of God? Then this is what you must do. As agents of mercy, we must be willing to stop for a moment, look at people, and love them. Somebody praise him.
Amen.
We must be able to stop what we're doing. How many of you acknowledge that we live busy lives? We already went over this last week. Amen. Very busy. Very productive lives. As Sister Rosie said, yesterday we were all over the place taking care of personal business, you know? Cleaning the house. How many of you cleaned your house yesterday? If you didn't clean your house, then I hope you cleaned it on Friday. Clean your house whenever you want to clean your house. If you don't want to clean it, don't clean it. That's up to you. But yesterday, we were busy. We were running around doing laundry, running around cleaning the house and doing yard work, and we were busy. But in the midst of that busy time, there were people reaching out to us, people that are in need. And I had to slow myself down, and I had to sit down. And I had to say, okay, I understand you're going through this. Let's make an appointment. Let's see if we can gather on this day. Let's see if we can sit down and talk. Because I know that you're in need. Amen?
Amen.
We live busy lives, but we must be interested in our brothers and our sisters, those that are going through trials, those that are going through hardship. Amen?
Amen?
If we are to be agents of mercy here on earth, then we must begin to apply these principles to our lives. We must be able to stop what we're doing, look at those that are in need, and love them. And that is exactly what Jesus did in this moment. In that particular moment, he stopped, he looked at this young man. He understood that this man had some questions, some concerns, some inquiries, and he loved him in that moment, and he gave him the solution. There has to be a time where you and I stop and give those people that are in need the solution. Amen?
Amen. That's right.
The book of Jude teaches us, show mercy to those whose faith is wavering. Rescue others by snatching them from the flames of judgment. There are still others to whom you need to show mercy, but be careful that you aren't contaminated by their sins.
Yeah.
Say what?
Yep.
Hallelujah.
That's deep.
We must show mercy to those whose faith is wavering. If you know a brother or sister that's faith is wavering, you must show mercy to them. Meaning, the word wavering means to not be still, to not be firm. It's like the waves of the ocean, wavering. Do we understand? Some people, they need that dramatic, visualization to understand it. Not all of you, but within the crowd, somebody understand what the word meant when I did this. But that's not for all of you. I know we have some intelligent people here. Amen. And so he continues by saying, rescue others by snatching them from the flames of judgment. There are people that you and I are going to have to rescue literally by snatching them out of the fire. How many of you know somebody that is possibly headed right towards the fire?
Yeah.
In their spiritual walk? We could say, whatever. And you know what the word normally is. But we won't say it. Our job is to snatch them out of the fire. If you see somebody that's going down the wrong path, don't wait to tell the pastor. If you have a relationship with that person, you tell that person. You'll be the one to say, listen, you might not want to continue living in that lifestyle because something bad's going to happen to you. The best thing that you could do is save a friend. Somebody praise them.
Amen. Yes.
If you have a relationship with them, then you tell them. Tell them, listen, I don't want to see you hurt. So today, it's very uncomfortable for me to go there, but today I have to go there because I love you. Don't go down that road. Because I already see where you're going. And even if they feel uncomfortable with you, trust me, they're going to get over it. And if they don't get over it, at the end of the day, I told you so. What's worse, to listen to the advice that you're being given or to hear the I told you so? Or what's better, I should say? What's better?
Listen.
To listen. Because the I told you so hurts. The I told you so is very annoying, and it jumps right on your nerves. Right?
That's right.
So the best thing we can do is listen to that counsel. And so he continues here, and he says, there are still others to whom you need to show mercy. So he says, right now you're showing mercy to some people, but there are still some other people that you need to show mercy. But be careful that you aren't contaminated by their sin.
Yeah.
There are people that are walking in sin and they need you to show mercy to them. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And we must show mercy to them. But be very careful that you don't fall in the same nonsense that they're in.
Yep. That's right.
So by showing mercy, does this mean that now we're going to start hanging with them more often and doing more of the things that they do? No. That's not what it means to show mercy. You help them out, you're in and out. You go in, help them out really quick and back out. Because if you're not careful, before you know it, you're doing the same things that they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So the word teaches us, yes, you must show mercy to somebody that needs mercy, somebody that's in sin. Listen. That's who we need to show mercy to, the people that are in sin. But be very careful that you don't end up doing the same things that they're doing.
Yep, that's right. That's right. Amen.
How many of you understand that God is calling us to live holy lives?
Yes, amen.
To live separated from sin. Mm. Well, you've been set free from sin, so come up out of that sin. Amen?
Amen.
Don't keep going to that. Mm. You've been set free. Everybody here has been set free.
Thank you, Jesus.
There is no exception. Every single person that believes in Jesus Christ, that accepts Jesus, is called to live a life of holiness, is called to live a life separated. Now, with this, I'm not saying that you got to be the perfect human being, because nobody in here is perfect, including myself. But we're talking about Jesus set us free from sin, and we don't have to go back to that sin, and we don't have to continue in that life. We must live separated from that, separated from sin. And so these are some of the principles of mercy. How can we show mercy? How can we be more merciful? By taking a moment to look at people, by loving people, by showing them mercy and being careful that we don't fall into the same nonsense that they're in. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4. And I'm glad you're with me today. Because we're going to, I'm telling you, man, we're going to travel this Bible front and back. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. When you have it, you can say amen. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good. Hallelujah. Praise God.
It's important for God's people to understand that. Listen, God is good when you get a flat tire.
Come on.
Amen?
Amen. Yeah, he is.
What, is he bad? Because you got a flat tire? God is good all the time. No matter what you're going through, God is good.
Yes, yes. Praise God.
1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. Are we there?
Amen.
Above all, keep your love for one another. Keep what?
Your love for one another.
Love one another, okay? And it says here, therefore, be clear-headed or sober-minded and disciplined for prayer. Love one another, but be sober-minded, clear-minded, and pray. Who do you think we should pray for? One another. Amen?
Amen.
If you know somebody's going through something, you love them. If they're getting on your nerves, you continue to love them. You can be firm. How many of you know that you can be firm with a person and still love them?
Yeah, amen. That's right. Yeah.
Because we are not charlatanes. Mm-hmm. Can I get an amen if you understand that? We are not charlatans. They said, what? The pastor's making up words right now. Challenge me. Pull up the dictionary. We are not charlatans. So you could love somebody and be firm with that person. Amen? To love somebody doesn't mean that they can step all over you and do whatever they want with you. You can love somebody but know how to put them in their place. Can I get an amen?
Amen. That's right.
If you don't know how to balance that, then you're going to be a doormat. Anybody want to be in the ministry of doormats? Not I, said the cat. Not I. I don't want to be a doormat. So I'm going to display love. But if I have to be firm and put you in your place, I'm going to do so. Because I love you. Can I get an amen?
Amen. Hallelujah. Amen.
Somebody felt the spirit right there. Or not.
Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah.
I'm telling you, we search in the scriptures today. Ephesians chapter 4. Let's go there. Ephesians is very close by. Turn a few pages. Somebody's like, that's easy for you to say, Pastor. You have tabs on your Bible. Get a Bible with tabs. They're all the same price nowadays. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2. God is good. All humility and gentleness with patience, accepting one another in love. Let's backtrack. Let's go to verse 1. Here the apostle says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk worthy of the calling you have received. How many of you acknowledge that you received a calling from God?
Yeah.
God called you. God chose you. Mm-hmm. He says, walk in a worthy manner. Amen. Mm-hmm. How do we walk in a worthy manner of our calling? He says here in verse 2, with all humility, meaning being humble, not only being humble, but being gentle. He says, with patience, accepting one another in love. We must walk in love and we must have patience towards each other. I know that there are times that our family members, our friends, and our neighbors do things that are out of line and we kind of lose patience. But here, the Bible teaches us, according to the Apostle Paul, that we have been called to a specific calling of reconciliation, the ministry of reconciliation, a ministry of love, a ministry of mercy. And if we are to walk according to the ministry that we've been called for, one thing that we must do with each other is learn how to show patience. Learn how to be patient with one another. Learn how to love one another. Amen. Learn how to display mercy. So now, this whole mercy thing, is this something that we should all be able to display? Or is this just for the leadership of the church? Only the leadership of the church is supposed to show mercy. No, this is for every single human being that has been shown mercy by God.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
You are called to be an agent of mercy. 007 of mercy. All of a sudden you like it now. Yeah, people are just like, I'm telling you, very fictional, very superhero-ish. Now you walk out of here and you're like 007 agent of mercy at your service. That's fine if it works for you.
Amen.
It's okay. Whatever. Listen, whatever works for you, whatever gets you to do what God is calling you to do, do it.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Right?
Yes. Praise God. Preach it.
Against these things, there are no laws. Nobody can talk about you. Hallelujah. If you are doing things that are enabling you to do the will of God, then you're in the will of God. There's no law against that.
Amen. Praise God.
And so, we continue here. Don't expect unbelievers to act like believers. Mm-hmm. Let's call this principle number one.
Yes.
Many times, you see people who you think are believers, but in actuality, they are unbelievers, and they're not acting the right way. Just because you see somebody in church doesn't mean that they are Christian, doesn't mean that they are a believer. There are people that like the way. They like the way. They like the culture. They like the harmony. They like the fellowship. They like the music. Whatever it is they like, when they go out, they continue living as a worldly person. Don't expect an unbeliever to act like a believer. Learn how to cut people some slack. Let's go to Matthew chapter 9, and I get my foundation from this set of scriptures. Matthew chapter 9. When you get there, say amen. Matthew 9, 10.
Amen.
9, verse 10. Actually, let's go from 9. 9, 9. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax office. And he said to him, "Follow me." So he got up and followed him. While he was reclining at the table in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came as guests to eat with Jesus and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well don't need a doctor, but the sick do. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice. For I didn't come to call the righteous, but the sinners." Here, in this particular case, what we see is Jesus gathering with sinners and gathering with unbelievers and worldly people. He has a dinner, and he invites this tax collector, Matthew, and he says, "Follow me." And so he invites him to his place where they were going to be eating together. And some of Jesus' disciples are like, and actually some of the religious scholars that were around, they were like, "But how is it," asking the disciples, "how is it that your master is eating with these people? These people are sinners. These people are the scum of town. The worst of the worst. How could he be eating with them?" And today, the message is mercy is how he was able to eat with those people. We must display mercy. Jesus displayed mercy. Jesus ate with sinners. Jesus ate with worldly people. Jesus was able to have influence on them, but they didn't have influence on Jesus. So the question is, so we could be around worldly people? Amen. Can we be around sinners? Amen. But you must be the influence over their lives.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And not allow them to influence you.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Now, does this mean that you could go to the club and just chill with the sinners but not be influenced by them? You see, don't twist the message today. No! No, Jesus wasn't at the club. He was eating. He was having dinner. Amen? Do we understand? He was having dinner, but in the midst of him having dinner, people are judging him because he's hanging with worldly people, with unbelievers that are not behaving the right way, that are not acting the right way according to, you know, the religious people. But Jesus, in that moment, he was having influence over their lives, and their lives were being saved because he took the time to stop, look at them, love them, show mercy,
yes,
and be with them.
Amen.
And so what we're called to do is to stop for a moment, look at these people, and love them and show them mercy.
Amen.
Now, does this mean that we're to allow them to have influence to us and before you know it, we're clubbing, we're partying, we're doing everything, the same things that they do. No, that's not what the word is teaching us. The word is teaching us that you can go with them, you can be with them, but do not allow yourself to be dragged down by them.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? And I'll tell you this, it's very hard. When you first come to the Lord, you still have an entourage of worldly people that surround you. People that, you know, you love, your family members, friends, people that are unbelievers, and here you are trying to look for God, and there they are trying to bring you back down as if they know what's best for you. They say, "No, trust me, just once." DK, looking out for you. But they're not looking out for you. Listen, if God brought you out of there, don't go back there.
Mm-hmm.
Tell your neighbor, if God brought you out of there, don't go back there. Your neighbor has to hear it. I might not be able to run to all of you and say that to you, but your neighbor can tell you, listen, don't run back to that. Jesus said right here, it very fascinating, his words. He says, "Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy and not sacrifice." There are people that feel that they can fast for a whole day and that's it, it's done. They sacrifice themselves. But the type of fast that God is requiring of his people is for us to love one another and for us to show mercy. Is it hard for you to fast? Somebody say amen. Be honest right now. It's hard for you to fast. You want to know another way to fast? By denying yourself. A fast is denying yourself of food. So you can actually fast by denying yourself of being unforgiving, heartless, careless, by being merciful, by being forgiving, by displaying love. Amen?
Jesus.
When you walk, you should always be kind and pleasant, so you will be able to answer everyone in the way you should. Does anybody know a person that is unapproachable?
Yes.
Listen. Stop looking at the person beside you right now. All right? I see some of you looking at each other like, don't play that in church. That's not what God is calling us to, okay? I saw a couple of you do this. Pastor. Snitching on the low. I'm on to you. When you walk, when you talk, you should always be kind and pleasant, so you will be able to answer everyone in the way you should, so that people don't look at you like this in church, give you the look, as if you are that unapproachable person. I know that I do not want to be that unapproachable person. I want to be the person that everyone can approach me. I don't want to be like this being that is like very fictional, and it's like I breathe upon you from here and everybody drops down. I don't want to be that fictional person. I want to be a normal person that you can approach and that you can have a conversation with. I'm more interested in that. The wisdom that comes from heaven is pure. Can I get an amen?
Amen. That's right.
Peace, loving, gentle at all times, and willing to yield to others. Wisdom is full of mercy. And these are words from the Apostle James. Wisdom is full of mercy. The person that operates in mercy is a wise person. What did we say last week about a person that displays mercy? That person gains mercy. How many of you want mercy?
Yes.
When you're going through the worst storm of your life, listen, you will go through storms in life. When you're going through the worst storm of your life, just because you were able to show somebody else mercy, God is going to show you mercy.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes.
Has anybody lived it?
Yes. Woo. Amen.
I've lived it. And God's people say,
amen.
What are places to be an agent of mercy is the question today. What are some places where we can be an agent of mercy? Let us look for people. Let's go to Galatians chapter 6 now. Galatians 6. What are places where we can be an agent of mercy?
Amen.
Galatians 6:2, are we there?
Amen.
Carry one another's burdens. In this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. So, what we can do to be an agent of mercy is find somebody that we know is burdened at the time and help them carry their burdens. By doing so, we show mercy. Look for somebody that's in need. Look for somebody that's struggling and help them carry their burden. When we do this, that's us showing mercy. Where else can we be an agent of mercy? Let's go to Romans 15. When you have it, say amen. Romans 15.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
15, verse 2. Are we there?
Amen.
Each one of us must please his neighbor for his good in order to build him up. For even the Messiah did not please himself. Jesus wasn't all about himself. Jesus would do things to please others. Now, does this mean that you have to do everything to please that person? No, there's a very thin line, and be careful because you can bring judgment upon yourself by doing so. But notice, the things that Jesus did wasn't only to please himself. Jesus was, what everything that Jesus did was to please God. But if you look into the ministry of Jesus, what he mainly did was help.
Yes, yes.
That's what we're talking about. Be an agent of mercy and look for people that need help and help them.
Yes.
If you agree, say amen.
Amen. Yes.
So we should build each other up by helping each other. Amen.
Amen.
Another place where we can be an agent of mercy. The first was find somebody that has a burden and help them carry that burden. A burden is a heavy load. It's something that they're dealing with that in all reality is too heavy for them, and they can't do it without support. We can be spiritual support. We can pray for somebody. We can come into agreement with somebody and help them through the situation that they're going through.
Yes.
You can display mercy by doing so. When somebody is going through that storm, instead of abandoning them, if you're there for them, then you have shown mercy. And as a result, you gain mercy for yourself when you go through the storm. And not only have you gained mercy, but you've gained a friend because you were with them when they were going through that storm.
Amen.
That's how you know who your true friends are, when you're going through a storm. I had one of my friends say, "We had many friends, but I remember when I was going through my storm, I got thrown in prison. And out of all my friends, he said, the only one that came to see me was you. That's when I knew who my real friends were. He said, because when I was going through my thing, everybody abandoned me. But you were the only one that was there for me, that took out of your time, that stopped to look, to love me and show mercy." You gain friends when you stop, look, love, and help them carry their burden. Help them go through the situation that they're going through. Against this, there is no law. I can't bring a better message than this, because against this, there is no law. This is what God has called us to be there for one another. Not to talk about each other and bash each other, but to be there for one another. Amen?
Amen. That's right.
We can make church a better place if we learn how to live in harmony and respect each other, respect boundaries.
Amen.
And help each other.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of talking about somebody and ruining their image and ruining their testimony, you speak highly about them. And even though things aren't in good terms between you and that person, you don't bash that person. This is what we're called to do. Show mercy. When you have the opportunity to harm somebody and you speak highly of them,
yeah,
right there, you're given the opportunity to show mercy. The Bible teaches us in the book of Corinthians, God himself comforts us in our troubles so that we can comfort others. Let's go there, actually. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Because I know some people go through some stuff and they're like, I don't know why God is allowing me to go through this. But God will allow you to go through something so that he can strengthen you through that, and so that you can be a help to others. Somebody said, but you don't know what I've been through. Exactly what you've been through is what God allowed you to go through to make you, not to break you, to strengthen you, so that when somebody else was going through that same situation, you could be of service, you could be of support,
yes.
You could show mercy, yes. You can show that person the way.
That's right.
Mm. Now we know why the Lord has allowed for us to go through these things. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, 3 to 4. We there?
Amen.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. Somebody praise Him for being the God of all comfort.
Amen.
Amen. We praise You because in all of our troubles, He comforts us. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Verse 4, He comforts us in all our afflictions. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So that we may be able to comfort those who are in any kind of affliction through the comfort we ourselves receive from God. So here He says that God comforts us so that when somebody else is going through a similar affliction, we may be able to comfort them because we were comforted first. Amen? So we can do this. Another place where we can be an agent of mercy is when we see somebody in need of comfort and we comfort them. In that moment, we are an agent of mercy. And there is a bank. There is a bank account that is assigned to every single person. And as you display mercy towards somebody else, you gain mercy and it's put away in that bank. And that bank has interest. And when it's time for you to go through the storm or for you to go through something, you can go and you can withdraw that mercy.
Amen.
I've been in storms myself and I have cried out to God and I've said, Lord, I need You to have mercy. And I've seen Him come down, swoop down, and pick me up out of whatever situation it is. Because of mercy. Because we display mercy. Look for people that are in need of mercy and show mercy. When people sin, you should forgive and comfort them, so they won't give up in despair. You know, one thing that I've noticed with the church is that once they see somebody sin, it's like it's over for that person. And the Word teaches us the contrary. The Word teaches us when somebody sins, you listen, it says, when people sin, you should forgive them, pardon them, and comfort them, so they don't give up in despair. People tend to give up on life. People tend to give up on living because they have missed the mark and people give their backs to them. The Bible teaches us instead of giving our backs to them, let us face them and love them and forgive them.
Yes.
Amen.
I wonder how many people you and I have to forgive, to love. The Bible teaches us, don't repay evil for evil. And somebody said, but that's the only way that I know. Never retaliate when people insult you or say unkind things about you. Did you hear that? Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 3. We're looking at this one together. First Peter chapter 3. Have you ever had anybody talk about you in a very shameful and disrespectful way?
Yes.
Can I get an amen?
Amen.
If you've been there, the first thing you want to do is crush that person.
No.
Right? But listen to what the apostle says. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. Are we there?
Amen.
We'll go from 8. Now finally, all of you should be like-minded and sympathetic. Be alike in one mind and have sympathy towards each other. Should love believers and be compassionate and humble. Not paying back, this is how we should deal with each other, the believers, the Christians. Not paying back evil for evil or insult for insult. When they've spoken about you, the first thing you want to do is lash out and speak about them. But he says, on the contrary, giving a blessing, since you are called for this, so that you can inherit a blessing. So when somebody curses you, the apostle is saying, bless them. And by doing so, you receive a blessing. When you hear that somebody's been running their mouth about you, you don't curse them, but you declare a blessing upon their lives, and as a result, you receive a blessing. How many of you prefer the blessing?
Yes. Amen. Yes. Yes.
So instead of cursing them as you would like to, you declare a blessing upon them. You declare mercy upon them. And as a result, you have mercy and blessing coming to you and getting deposited into your account. Amen?
Amen.
So again, today's message was titled, Being an Agent of Mercy in the World. Can somebody declare, I will be an agent of mercy in this world. In Jesus' name, in God's people's name.
Amen.
Amen. Why don't we all stand? Heavenly Father, we want to thank you right now for allowing us to be here on this beautiful afternoon. We humble ourselves before you. We acknowledge the ministry that you're calling us to. Every single one of us, you're calling us to a ministry of mercy. Father, at this moment, we pray that you may continue to work in us. Work in our lives, work in those areas of our lives where we need to be molded. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you may have your way upon us. We understand what you're doing, God, and we're going to yield to you, Heavenly Father. We're going to yield to your guidance. We're going to yield to your leading in Jesus' name.
Your faithfulness is true.
and we're desperate for your presence. All we need is you, Lord. We're waiting here for you. Singing.